You can believe in demons or not. Either way, some people have had an experience with what they truly believe is a demon, and I'm gonna share their stories because they deserve to be heard. Hi, most amazing fam. I'm Abby, your host for this video, Top 10 Scary Messages from Demons. And side note, I have a little message for you, like a scary message. Like us on Facebook, we are posting exclusive content over there, but I didn't tell you that. Now you know. Anyways, I was able to find two people who had quite a few experiences with demons, or what they think to be demons, so I'll be stringing those experiences together, the ones that happen back to back, so nobody gets lost with these stories. And of course, plus I have a few others from some other people to mix it up, so without further ado, because this one might be a little long, let's get to the demons. Starting off, Reddit user Rakora had a couple of run-ins with what she thinks could be some demons, or one demon, because she was a part of a paranormal team in the UK called Two Haunted Venues and then Two Haunted Investigations. So we will be referring to her as Sherry, and thank you, Sherry, for giving me permission to share your stories. But that brings us into number 10. One of Sherry's stories, and it's a medium takeover. Now, this experience happened to one of her team members at the time, Mark, and he is a physical medium, so he lets spirits communicate through him with his energy instead of other common ways of mediumship, like interpreting messages or other things like that. Not to like shame any type of medium, but there's different ones. And it's also important to note that Sherry says that she trusts Mark and his words, so we can kind of believe in the authenticity of these experiences. But basically, on a night of filming a Halloween special, Mark had what appeared to be a possession, or at least a negative experience with a spirit that was using his body. Apparently, it was a negative energy he had encountered before that was so bad that it had caused him to foam at the mouth, and his wife couldn't even snap him out of it. In this instance that Sherry saw, he was laying on the ground after collapsing and talking gibberish. As people tried to get him up or try to move him, he woke up, but Sherry said something felt off. While he had no physical changes, it was like it wasn't him. His voice was different, and looking at his face didn't really seem like it was Mark. He thrashed and resisted people helping him so much that someone's hand was forced against a wall and cut. It took six big guys to carry a slightly smaller Mark outside, and it smelt like sulfur, which can be known as a sign of demonic possession. And it took days for Mark to recover from this. So could this have been a demon that resurfaced for a second time, or a tormented spirit? What do we think? But let's move on next at number 9, in the mirror. In 2017, a Reddit user on a now deleted account shared their story of a weird circumstance from their childhood. When they were 11 or 12, they stayed at their grandparents' house quite a bit. They stayed in the guest bedroom in the basement that went underused in between visits, and weird things kind of started happening. Things moved around in the room when they shouldn't have, and since the basement wasn't really accessible to their older relatives, they were kind of like, what's happening? There was a comb that was on the nightstand when before it was on the vanity, and then there were crumbs from a snack, but they didn't eat in that room, so yeah. Then they would wake up in the middle of the night to see greasy messages on the mirror of the vanity across from the bed. They didn't do them, and their grandparents couldn't really get there, so this is kind of what put them on edge the most. When they went to look in the mirror or to see it, they saw something behind themselves, so they turned around only to see there was nothing there. At that point, a chill overtook them, and when they returned to look in the mirror, it appeared as if the sheets moved behind them, and they thought, oh, nope, I am not sharing the bed with the demon, and went up to sleep on the living room couch. And I think that message was pretty clearly that someone had already made its home in the guest bedroom at Granny's. So, had to get out. But that's not the only way demons can communicate. At number 8, we have the devil has a cell phone. Back in 2014, a Polish priest named Father Marian Raschel carried out an exorcism on a teenage girl. He claims he wasn't able to drive the demon out of her soul, and as a result, is receiving taunting text messages from the demon through the teenage girl's phone. He said that the author of these texts is an evil spirit who has possessed her soul. And I know you want to know what some of these texts said, because seems like a quite unique circumstance. So here are some examples. One is, she will not come out of this hell. She's mine. Anyone who prays for her will die. And so Priesty replied kind of something along the lines of, I will pray for her. And then he got another response saying, shut up, preacher. You cannot save yourself, idiot. You pathetic old preacher. Which is kind of rude, but he said she should get further help for her possession. So was it a demon or a prank? I want to know. But if you think text is the only demon tech communication, think again, because at number 7 we have email chain. Now, years ago, a story circulated around on Reddit and Tumblr about a girl named Danny who tried to start a cursed email chain. If you don't remember those chains, they essentially said to forward the email to like 5, 10, or even more of your friends, or else you will have bad luck for eternity or something like that. Now, Danny's friends who told the story said that she seemed to grow more and more anxious and kind of unhinged as she prepared to communicate with a number of demons to try to make the scariest email chain possible. When she finally got in contact with one, apparently it sent her an email. No subject line, no sender, and only one phrase: desisto. And that's one of the Latin words for stop. Now, the next day at school, she told all of this to her friends, who were thankful because they hoped this sign would get her to stop, but she laughed at them and told them it was just the beginning. Now, this didn't really sit right with her friends, and it didn't really seem like her anymore, and it seemed like a different person talking in her body, so they were kind of thrown off, and then after that, her friends just never saw her again. Now, many people assume she just did this as a prank and then moved away, but it was never confirmed what happened, so was it a demon emailing her? Demailing her, maybe? That doesn't sound right. On to number 6, scratches from a demon. Now, this is the start of a string of events from Sherry, aka Reddit user Akora. She did a public ghost hunt at Dudley Castle, and weird stuff happened in the dark. Basically, this team had people laying in these two stone coffins where it was common to feel like there is a pressure on your chest, like someone is pressing on it, and during this, there was also a seance with a medium happening at a different table. Over at the medium, while not too much was happening, one of the guests said he felt like his face was burning, like the feeling after you've been slapped. I was just about to slap myself, but I won't. Anyways, they checked up on him, but he said he was all right. Then once the seance ended and people were getting out of the coffins, one of the people said their chest felt tight, so they put on all the lights for health and safety reasons, which is great. But then people gasped across the room by the medium. In Sherry's own words, the gentleman who had been slapped during the seance had 3 scratches down his face. They weren't human fingernail size, they almost looked like a cat had swiped his face, like really thin lines down his face. They were bleeding slightly, and we had to administer official first aid as an incident on site. Now, the weird thing is, he never touched his face the entire time, as there were multiple cameras covering the event even in the dark room, kinda like dark light cameras. Really, that's a message not to mess with dark stuff if I've ever seen it. I'm already enough of a scaredy cat. Cat scratches too, wow. That's not even where the story ends. At number 5, dense darkness. So right after that, once the gentleman was moved and cleaned up in the next room to help with the scratches, the room was dark once again, and Sherry had her own unnerving experience. She stood next to the empty stone coffins and could feel a presence beside her. She could only see it in her periphery, but she described it as dense black, smaller than human, but human-like, with an almost goat-like face. Kind of like Shadows, super tight. That type of dense black. And even when she turned to face it head on, she said it seemed as if she was getting an incomplete peripheral vision. It made her uncomfortable to the point that she even swapped places with a teammate. She noticed that her teammate may have felt the same presence, but he was enough of a skeptic that he didn't talk about it. Ever. She thinks that it could have been a demonic presence. Which leads me to number 4, final message from Dudley Demon. A year or so later, during a Halloween event, the same one where Mark had his unfortunate negative experience we talked about earlier, the team caught a mysterious image on camera. Sherry believes the image matches the demon or being she saw in one of the years prior, although another teammate says it was a cat. But what is more haunting about the story is that Sherry believes a demon, maybe that same demon in the photo, came home with her. That night, they caught the questionable footage. She was at peace after all of the like questionable happenings and things that threw her off, but that wasn't normal for her. She was the like, sit down, decompress, don't sleep, lights on, watch a Disney movie type thing. Like, even as a paranormal investigator, she needed to do that. But this time, she was so calm. No one was at home, and she was blissful, living her life. She even heard steps up and down the stairs and felt like there was a presence outside her bedroom door, but knew no one was home. But she just passed out easy, unfazed, woke up right as rain. And you might be dismissing this as a nice coincidence of a good night's sleep, but just wait for it. A year later, going back to this same castle, Dudley Castle, for the first time since the last time, where Mark had his possession and they caught the strange footage, Sherry had forgotten about all this, but the second she stepped out the front door with all of her gear ready, something just washed over her. She felt feverish and like she was gonna pass out, and this kept going to the point that she was willing to try a spiritual cleanse with her medium. But when she walked through the archway in the castle courtyard, the feeling just lifted off her. It felt like something, the demon, had used her body as a lift back and forth, just wanted like a year's vacay from the castle, and then like hitched a ride. Maybe. I think that honestly makes the most sense. But let's go to number 3, a demon in his home. Reddit user Annoying Rooster wanted to share his story 3 years ago about a run-in with a demon that made him move out of his place. It all started when he had a really bad dream at the beginning of October. He recounted parts of it, like something hovering over his bed and giving him a disgusted look, and then waited minutes passed and something said in a faint whisper. It was just a weird dream, and he dismissed it as a nightmare and just went out for a walk. He locked his door on the way out, cleared his head for a couple hours. Kind of a good idea. I like taking walks. But when he came back, his front door was just wide open. He was thrown off, obviously, and a bit shaken, but he dismissed it. But that wasn't the end of it. At number 2, demon's back. Back again. A bit later that month, he got home late and his house was more heated than usual. It was really cold outside and it was just like 83 degrees Fahrenheit in his house. He thought that was kind of weird, but then he just went and gamed on his computer, like we all do. But then, a couple hours later, he heard a bang in another room in his apartment. No one was there, even when he went to search, but he found a large hole against his wall and his snow globe had fallen over and cracked and dented. And when he went back to his computer, it was off. And not asleep, but off, like the VGA cord was unplugged and he felt like he was being watched. So he, on a whim, took a photo, and in the photo, there were 2 red eyes looking at him. After that, there were more small incidents, seeing things from the corner of his eye, hearing knocking and footsteps, but it all came to a head on December 4th, which leads us to our number 1, demon eviction. Now, at this point, Reddit user Annoying Rooster, he was kinda used to small tapping noises and dismissed them, but on December 4th, he heard a loud slam, so he waited and then investigated. He was checking to see why his bathroom light that he always left on was off when he felt an extreme burning sensation on the back of his hand, and there were 3 scratch marks across the top. He made his way back to his bedroom and looked back to the bathroom to see the form of what must have been a demon in the bathroom doorframe. To quote, "I saw what looked like something so tall its head touched the ceiling. It was all black, but with distinct features of a huge figure and what looked to be also horns on the top of its head. It also had the same piercing red eyes as the photo." So he did the smart thing and grabbed what he needed for work the next day and got the heck out of there. Cause if it can leave a physical touch, it's something. You know. And so he moved out completely and found out that the owner of the home, much later, had passed and the house caught on fire and burnt to the ground. So he doesn't want to know how or why, but obviously something off was there. But that's where I'm ending it. Those are all the scary messages demons have given people that I have for you today. And I feel like it's one thing to have a one-off instance, but it's a whole other thing when it's like repetitive and overbearing and like makes you fear for your safety. So stay safe, y'all. And tell me what you think or if you have had demon experiences down below. And while you're down in the comments, give us a like and subscribe, and you know, check me out on Instagram and send me cat videos, you know, that'd be great. Not demon cats though, nice cats. Or demon cats, like the black ones that are like, anyways, I need something nice to think about hearing all of those scary stories, but also remember my secret message, like us on Facebook for exclusive content. Anyways, that's all I have, until next time, goodbye. Because I need to like look alive. Can you see the bags under my eyes? Yeah, that's how it is. It's November, woo. I start the video with, "What it do, baby?" Imagine. "What it do, baby? Welcome back." Yeah, the next one, the sponsored one, "What it do, baby?" Woot. It wasn't his mom, it was his wife. Why did I write mom?
Roller.
I was on a roll. Okay, I didn't scroll back far enough.
I think I'm good. I'm
like, oh. Demons. Okay. Demons back. Back again. A bit. Don't laugh. Yay!